Let us adore you. when more are hungry and thirsty, and the price of life has never been so low. There has never been a night when more are seeing and dreaming that all that Jesus paid was for the love of all mankind. So in a time of rain, we will ask for rain. In the rainy season,
oh,
living in the days of awe, we're living in the days of wonder. Living in the days of wonder, living in the days of awe, we're living in the days of wonder, living in the days of awe, we're living in the days of wonder, living in the days of awe, we're living in the days of wonder. Oh, come. the days of old. So let every eye be open that we may adore Jesus Christ our Lord. We're in the days of old.
Thank you. Everlasting
There's a song down under, like the sound of thunder, as the voices of the suns begin to roar. And all the love that you have poured out shall return to you like rivers. to know you more. We want to know you more. We want to know you, Jesus, all of you.
Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you that we are in a time, that Australia is in a time of great awakening. God is not coming, it's here right now. Father, we thank you that we are knowing you more. Father, we thank you that the people of God are getting to know you at an even deeper level at this time. And Father, we thank you that those that don't yet know you are going to get to know you. Father, we thank you, God, that this is a time of beautiful harvest too. That you said that all will know me from the least of them to the greatest. And Father, we thank you that that's a prophetic word over Australia, God. We thank you, God, that all will know you, God, from the least of them to the greatest. So Father, we give you glory and honor and praise in this place for everything that you're doing in the nation of Australia and in the nations of the earth. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand. Let's give the Lord a shout of praise in this place. Awesome. So good. Well, find someone to love for a few minutes. Get to know someone maybe that you've never met before. And then find a seat. You just want to find a seat. So good. Just want to invite Tanya to come and share something that she saw during worship, a really powerful vision.
In the last part of that worship, as we were sort of singing free worship, at the end, and I could feel it building to like a crescendo. And then I had this incredible vision of the great cloud of witnesses in heaven, and I've seen them before, and they're in multi-tiers, you know, layers in this of like inner building. It's lots and lots and lots of tiers, and there's thousands of them, and they look down and they encourage us and they're inspiring us. But for the first time, as our worship was rising, I saw them all become flames of fire. They all became flames, and the more our worship took off, the more inflamed they became. And they were so excited, and they were worshiping, and we were worshiping. And then the fire in them, I realized, was in us, that the flame in us was growing and growing and growing as our worship took off to new levels today.
Come on. I just wanted to explain that, you know, I mean, I know that many of you who come to this church, you're used to that free time of worship and what happened, but I said to Finn, I felt like we went into an intercessory mode where we were interceding. Today is the first of the 10 days of awe, Rosh Hashanah, is that right? The beginning, Rosh Hashanah. And so what Jewish people that don't believe that Messiah has come do the very introspective thing, but I felt like the kindness and the pleasure of God was over all of his body, and it was like I couldn't tell the difference anymore between Jew or non-Jew. And it was such a tremendous thing. I'm so encouraged about that cloud of witnesses. Do you know that Moses, Abraham, Jacob, all the guys we read about in the Bible, they're all on that cloud. They don't look at you any differently and going, oh wow, those are the other guys. It's like they're one with us, and we make their face and their whole their representation much more complete. So I don't know if you were aware of it, and it doesn't matter if you weren't fully aware of it. The reality is as you enter more and more, as you flow more and more with what we're doing, we get caught up in a place where it's not just us singing songs and people wondering, I wonder what's the next song. It's we're caught up in a place of worship, and we do what he does. And so today we were liberating people of Sydney and the people that are actually starting to celebrate, and we were declaring over them, let every eye be open to see what we see. Isn't that wonderful? We get to partake. We are partakers. And I really do believe that we were like Esther today, raising up the scepter, which is our sound, which is our voice, which declares into the atmosphere what we can't see happening. That's what faith is. Hello. You're creating something that's ahead. And we might be singing 1, 2, 3 years ahead, but I tell you, some of you will still be around. You'll say, I remember that day. And you're going to see a great outpouring on Jewish believers, on Jewish people everywhere. There are so many in the city. There's going to be an outpouring that will be spoken about in Israel, I'm telling you.
Wow. Isn't that amazing? Oh, gosh, it's more than amazing. How many of you knew that you were actually worshiping with a lot of heavenly people today? So good. That's awesome. Well, welcome to Jubilee. If you've never been here before, just give us a wave if you've never been here before. I know it's embarrassing. Oh, welcome. Thank you so much. You don't need to do anything more than that. I just want to just bless the people. That's so good. Listen, if you've never been before or you still... How many of you know that it's good to be connected to family? It's good to be connected to family. And how many of you know it's good to be connected to church family? So those of you that don't yet feel really connected to the church family here, just want to encourage you, come and grab a cup of coffee outside, meet some of the leaders, and we just love to, and the congregation, we just love to hang out with you and get to know you, because this is family, and it's a season of family. It's beautiful. Awesome. So good. Well, let's start with doing the offering. So if the guys can come, guys ready to take up the offering, that would be awesome. Then we've got a very, very special announcement after that. So I'm just going to let you guys do that first. While we're doing that, I'll just share a very brief financial testimony. A few weeks ago, I had an experience where I was purchasing something over the phone. And when you make an order over the phone for this particular thing, you can't unarrange it. You've bought it. And so I was on the phone, and suddenly, some of you know, I've just had a newborn baby. So I'm holding Asher in one arm, And I'm making a phone order with the phone here. And then the doorbell rang. So I was like, okay. So I said, hold on. I said, do not put the order through. I need to go and answer the door. I said, look, I'll ring you back in a few minutes. So anyway, it is what it is. I didn't ring back because I was so occupied with other things. And a few days later, I got an email through from the company saying, thank you so much for your order. That's brilliant. That was really good. And it wasn't a small thing, you know. I rang them straight away. I said, how could you do this? I told you not to put the order through. That's not okay. And they said, sir, can you check how much the thing is that we put the order through for last week now? I said, sure, I'll do that. And I had a look, and it was at least $1,500 to $2,000 more. And they said, would you still like us to cancel the order at the price that you bought it at? Or would you like to just keep the order? I said, let me keep the order. That's amazing. That's awesome. So I just want to encourage you that sometimes even God will work even in your accidents to make sure that you get blessed and make sure that you get a reward financially. It's amazing. Isn't God amazing? Isn't he a God of the abundance? He really, really is. And he's a God who loves to prosper his people. So exciting. So on that, I really want to so I'd like to invite Fini to come to announce something that's going to happen. Then we're going to hear from Jordan as well.
Come on. Well, you know that we have the Create conference coming up, and we've lived for some time with some of our gear that's worked really well, some hasn't worked so well, and there comes a time when you have to purchase new items, but then rather than purchase one, you've got to kind of, everything flows on, new software, new hardware, new cameras, etc. So we've released Jordan to just completely put a plan together, which he'll tell you about this morning, but it's exciting. It's all happening in the next few weeks.
Good morning, guys. How's everyone going? Good, enjoying spring so far? Blowing your nose heaps, taking lots of things that stop you from wanting to die. So guys, basically the vision for this new project, we're calling it the expansion, Jubilee expansion, because what we want to do is we want to set up infrastructure to support where God is taking us in the next 5 to 7 years. And where I believe that is just extending our arms of media coverage globally. A lot of you know that we've had probably 60,000 hits on our Ustream channel. And so what we want to do is we want to create... We want to be able to share what we do here with the world. A lot of you will remember when we tore down the old stage probably about 2 years ago and just started the process of change and upgrade. And so what we've done is, this is something that I had in my heart probably for the last 5 years. 2 years ago when we did this, we didn't have the resources to do what I wanted to do, and I thought, well, okay, well, this is a start. And so we've been saving for at least a year, putting money away every week. And so we've built up quite a decent amount of savings, completely separate to the building fund, which we're going to sow into this new infrastructure. I don't know how else to explain it. So what that means is we're getting new broadcast cameras, we're getting a new mixing console, we're getting new sounds, new lighting, a completely new stage. And it's just very exciting. A lot of this stuff has been donated to the church. We've had a tremendous amount of favor on this project. I went into a lighting store and they just so happened to be getting rid of all their ex-hire gear and gave me probably about $12,000 worth of theater lighting for free. So when you wait on the timing of God, he looks after you. And amen, right? So I'm very, very excited about this. We're going to be taking up offerings just so that we can create a buffer. We don't want to just deplete our savings and be in a bit of a struggle. So if that's something that you have on your heart, if you love what we do here, if you want to share this with the world, if you want to help us just do things better and have systems in place to facilitate what we do, then please sow into that. We will have donation cards for the next 4 weeks, starting from next Sunday. And so please come prepared to give. There's no pressure, there's no obligation. We do have savings, and we're not touching the building fund, for those of you worried. And also, if you're thinking, hold on a second, you're about to sow a whole bunch of money back into this building, are we going to buy it? I'll answer that question now. Most of, probably 80% of the stuff that we're sowing our money into, we will be able to take. If for any reason we don't get this building, we will be able to take to the next place. So we're not sinking your money into... a shaky investment. So please give with confidence and know that we are really using the money as frugally as we possibly can. And I can't wait to show you guys what we've done. So the new building will be opening the 26th of this month. So we start building on the 21st. It'll be up and ready by the 26th. So pray for us. It's going to be a busy week. Thanks.
Man, isn't that exciting? Oh, I'm so glad that I'm in this house. Isn't that just so exciting? A time of expansion. Shift is happening. It's so beautiful. I'm so, and bless you, Jordan, for taking, for everything he does behind the scenes, and everything that he's taking on at this time. We just release a blessing to him and extra grace for everything that he's putting his hand to. Isn't it awesome? Love just watching the favor. Just watch the favor that God's already put on this house. Just start to outwork as well. So, so good. So exciting testimonies. Simon, if you want to come.
What's crack-a-lackin'? Just quickly about Jordan. I mean, many people don't see what he actually does behind the scenes. He spends most days and nights, and he rings me and he's like, I wanted to sleep in today, but I woke up thinking about how we're going to do this thing. And he's like, even on his days off where he's sleeping, he's like, oh, what do you think about this price and stuff? And I mean, he's like had his heart in this thing since, I mean, what, he's been since like 8 on the drums or something. I didn't even know instruments existed when I was 8. I was doing other stuff. But it's like you see him worshiping at the front. And so half the time he's looking at angels, and the other half is like, we can hang it from there. And it's like, come on, can we just give him like a round of applause for his heart in this house? He honestly has the most pure heart and humble heart to see God's kingdom expand. Seriously, come on, why don't we stand up? He deserves a standing ovation, if anyone does. Come on. I mean, Izzy and Fini have dug a spiritual well, but Jordan has been their right-hand man that has got the ideas and the visions here. I mean, everything, the purchases, everything. So anyway, back to Jesus, which isn't far off. What was I saying? Oh, yeah, I was selling some gear. Take that. I was selling some gear this week, and I had this buyer come to my house. This old school rocker, he's like ponytail, look like Jordan except 60 or something. And it was hilarious. He comes around, he's like, got some stairs going up into the back of our place. And he gets the stairs and he goes, oh no. I'm like, what's up? And he's like, I'm going to an operation tomorrow. I'm like, yes, this is awesome. He goes, I'm going for an operation tomorrow. I can't remember what it's called, the thing where you get, he said L4, but it shoots pain down one leg. Sciatica, crazy thing. It hurts, okay? And he's had it for years. I mean, he's toured and traveled, and he's like carrying heavy gear, and he's just totally done himself. So I'm like waiting for him as he's literally going up each stair. Like, it's really bad. Booked in for the operation tomorrow, and I was like, I got him up, did business first, then friends. And then he asked about music. He's like, oh, so what music are you playing? Blah, blah. I was like, I love Jesus and all that stuff. And then we got out to his car, helped him load some stuff into his car. And I'm like, you know, I'm not going to let you be able to let you go until I pray for you. I mean, you can't just be limping around me and not get prayed for. And he's like, he's thinking, pray for me away from me kind of thing. So I was like, yeah, cool, awesome. And so I'm like, all right, come here. And I put my hand on his back and in the name of Jesus, command full healing. This is like outside this pub and like all these people around. And he's like, and I'm like, try. And he's like, oh, thank you. And then I'm like, try it out. It's like, oh, it's actually a little bit looser. And I go, okay, we're going again. Went about 3 times. He gets completely healed. And he's like almost crying. He got more than he paid for, if you know what I mean.
Isn't that awesome? So good. How many people need to be healed right now? How many people have got problems in the backs? Just stand up. Simon, come and just release a prayer.
Yeah, come on, everyone. I'm talking like niggly things as well, like things that you're like, oh, it's okay. Oh, look how many niggly issues we have. This is awesome. Right now, in Jesus' name, I command a full healing every niggly problem that keeps coming back, just go right now. You have no place in any believer's body, or even in my presence. You have no place in our presence. Even if you're a non-believer in here today, you have no place for sickness if you're in the presence of me and every other believer. But I've totally believed that right now, complete healing, fire in every part. Holy Spirit, you know what's going on. You know what's going on right now. Complete healing right now. Just while staying in that place, 2 weeks ago, someone comes up to me and goes, I've got 4 issues. And I'm like, oh, I don't even care what they are. And I just put my hand on him. And then I said, Holy Spirit, you know what's going on. Complete healing. And he gets completely healed of everything. He didn't even tell me what it was. He just tried everything out. He's just getting completely healed. So right now, Holy Spirit, you know what it is. Complete healing to every bone, cell, muscle, tissue, blood, whatever, God, you know what's up. Thank you, Jesus, for complete healing. No more. Go. Cancer, go. Pain, go. Everything, go. Backs, legs grow out right now. Pain, go. Curved spines, arches, we thank you for fullness, God. Fullness right now. In Jesus' name. Why don't you try that out right now? Whatever you got going on, try it out right now. Why don't you just wave your hand if you're feeling a difference? Come on, we got hands everywhere. This is crazy. All right, come on.
Come on. Isn't that awesome? Healed by 12:18. Isn't that so, so good? So good. Awesome. Just a practical note for giving for the expansion project. Next week we'll have specific envelopes or another way of giving. So from next week and then for some weeks after that. So let's welcome Fini as he comes to preach the word this morning.
Just before I do, we're going to pray for some folk this morning. Yvette and Rob, are you guys here? Come on. We've got folk that are moving to the Northern Territory, and I married them just recently, and so they're newlyweds, but also going to have a family, and they're moving to family, and we're going to miss you guys. So those of you that are friends with Rob and Yvette, why don't you just come out and stand with them? We're going to believe God to bless them, and release them with favor and love and honor, and growth is already evident. But you know, when we have family with us and we release them to other states and other places, it isn't easy, but it also is a blessing because we get to sow our best into the nations and into the nation. And so there's a sadness, but there's also a joy that Yvette's mum lives up there and they've got new jobs to go to, and so it's a time of expansion, opportunity, and God's going to multiply you, not just like that, but all that you've learned and received and been faithful to here in Sydney, God's going to increase it in your move. So Father, we just thank you, Lord, for Rob and Yvette and the little one that's coming, and we thank you, Father, that you have their future in your hand, that you always take us from strength to strength and glory to glory. So we bless you both, that this move will be a successful move. It'll be a blessed move. It'll be a move of favor. And we bless you as you move, that every detail will be taken care of, that you will walk into such an amazing season of love and being cosseted by God. And everything you've learned and received and fought for in Sydney will become so evident in your move in the Northern Territory. You'll see such an expansion of God in your lives, and you'll think, wow, we didn't know we knew so much. And you'll meet people that know so little and have so little, and you'll be imparting so much, because out of the overflow God's given you, you're going to pour out much in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen, amen. Amen. But you got to keep tithing to Jubilee. That's a joke. I also want to just honor and welcome our very special guest this morning, who is Danny Izzy's sister. Why don't you stand, Dan? Just want to welcome you to our church this morning. Woo! She really surprised us when we went to Cape Town a few years ago to visit her. And she said, I've got a surprise for you guys. I said, well, what is that? We're going to go to the circus. I said, oh, that's cool. No, we're going to beat the circus. So she took us to an organization that has circus experiences with trapeze, with no one there, just you on the trapeze in a harness. Let yourself go, go. I'm, ooh, okay. So that was Danny's surprise for us in Cape Town, and we've recovered, and it's all good. I want to ask Izzy this morning to share a word with us. I've got it printed out for you because you won't remember it probably. But two or three weeks ago, she had a word over the church about the 4 months of embers, or the 4 months of burning, the 4 months of fire. And I felt it's a word for today. We are in the season of Rosh Hashanah, the 10 days of awe between the Jewish New Year, which begins tonight, 10 days to Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, the most holy day in the calendar. And there's just a sense of, how do we prepare ourselves for the season that we're going into? Some people have said, you know, it's the end of the world, Jesus is coming back, and, you know, if that's you, you know, you could be wrong. But I won't tell you that. I wouldn't say that. Just because God said that there's 4 months of burning coming up. So I don't think Jesus is actually coming back. And the other reason why is theologically, Jesus said that this gospel will be preached to every nation, and then the end will come. And there's multitudes of nations that, remote tribes and villages and places where there's no gospel and no yet written version of the Word of God, no church being planted. And even in the last 10 years, there's been such an exponential increase of the gospel being reached in unreached people that the next 10 years are going to be extraordinary if Jesus tarries. But either way, we win. If those who believe it's all, you know, Jesus is coming back on tomorrow, I'm going to be in my bathers at Tamarama. So he can find me there. And I'll be very happy to receive that if that's the calling. I'll have a towel. And sunscreen, and I'm ready for Jesus' return, all right? But I suspect that we got more years on the planet, that there's lots of people to be reached, and there's just a movement in the earth that is not complete. There's a shaking and a moving, and I'll talk more about it in my message, but I want Izzy to share that word with us because it's a word for the church. It's not for me to read.
I think I remember it, but I will very kindly look at it. I saw the last five letters of 4 months, which is, you know, September, October, November, December, and I kept seeing the words ember, 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 and the Lord said 4 months of embers burning, 4 months of, like, it felt like an intensified heat. And so oftentimes, even when I've read words, I've thought, oh, what have I got to do in order for this to happen? I really felt the Lord say, take all the pressure off. It's not about massive fasts or you having to try and do anything different other than this is the vision I had. It was people just leaning into this blue flame. And I looked up at the hottest part of a flame if you're looking at a candle or a Bunsen burner. There is a blue and white part that burns at about 1,400 degrees Celsius. And it's the hottest part. And all we were doing is leaning into the hottest part of the covenant. I could see that this flame represented everything that Jesus Christ had accomplished for us. And it felt like it was a positioning into the very center of everything that he'd done. It was like coming into a greater awakening and like an intensifying heat of understanding the covenant between Jesus Christ and us as the bride. And so that's really what it was. We were leaning in, and I saw this. I saw us all becoming part of it, and he just said, this is an opportunity for you to respond. And so I just said, well, lean in. You know, when I do that, I actually physically go, and I'm like, okay, if the blue flame is here, I'm just leaning in, and I'm going to meditate on everything that he has done. So be aware of the fact that you might feel pressure to do more stuff, to feel like you haven't done enough for God, and all those things come up when God isn't, when the Lord lifts up almost like the awareness of something. And so oftentimes we go, gee, I thought this was going to be 4 months of fun. You might be challenged in just your understanding of what you think it means to be a believer. And so be prepared just to lean into what he has already done for you. That's how you stay burning hot. And the other thing that I saw was that I saw possibly 4 consecutive heat waves. Yay. So all I thought was just keep hydrated, people. Just get that water bottle out and just keep drinking water. Don't get dehydrated, okay, because I've warned you. It's going to be a hot summer, But I also believe that God is actually preparing us for a really... Australia is a hot nation. Everyone talks about what is happening in Australia. And I believe we can, in advance, begin to pray even for the fire, the firemen and the fire societies, the people that, all the volunteers, so that we don't have properties that burn down in these heats. It's like God is saying, will you be the solution? And you, instead of us saying, yeah, there'll be lots of fires, a lot of... No, we're actually a solution. We're a salvation and a sozo to this nation. So embrace that and lean in the blue flame and keep drinking.
Some of you might have been in the 9 a.m. service a few weeks ago when Jonathan Welton was with us, and he gave a very good and theological explanation of the passage in Revelations where it says Jesus is speaking to the church and saying, I wish that you were, would that you were hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. And of course, for years that most of the church has believed that, you know, you should be hot. People that are hot are those that get sweaty in worship. They kind of here early and up front and they sing and dance and prophesy, and the people that are lukewarm are those that come 15 minutes late and they can't find a car space and they only give 8% of their income and they're a bit ragged, but they come to church and they're not quite hot. And he said nothing could be further from the truth. Actually, Jesus was speaking into an actual demographic, an actual geographical location of 3 cities. The one was over Hot Springs, and he gave the names of the towns. I can't remember them, but they're there in the scripture. And that town was a town where people would go on holiday. They would go to get healing. They would go to these hot springs, and there was this incredible healing that came out of that town. And on the other extreme, there was a town that was near the mountains, not far, but with enough elevation to have beautiful, cold, fresh streams coming from that mountain, which is why the Lord said, I wish you were hot or cold. You can be really cold, which cold is a great refreshing. If you're hot, it's great to get cold. Amen? Like when you're hot, you go to the beach to have a swim to get cold. So I want to be hot and cold. And then the lukewarm was the town in the middle where the hot water that was piped under these aqueducts actually got lukewarm by the time it got to this town, and the ice cold water that was in this other town, which was full of refreshing, also became lukewarm. And this middle town was actually lukewarm, and it smelled because the there wasn't enough heat to push the water right through, so the aqueducts became salinified, or what the word is, calcified and stagnant, and that was the reason why you needed it to be hot or cold. So I would like to have a hot and a cold church. I want to be hot and cold. Come on. Just whatever's appropriate. I was reminded of that. And these days that we're living in, I want to share another prophetic word. It doesn't sound quite as authentic when it comes from me, but I couldn't get Johnny to stay for the whole morning. He was in the morning service at 9, and he shared this prophetic vision that he had at prayer meeting 2 Wednesdays ago, just on the theme of fire. And during that harp and bowl, how many know that we come to the harp and bowl to release fire, to release prayer, to release the nations? Even as we're praying for Jewish people this morning, and God gives us that unction to pray, let every eye be open. It's a prayer for us, but it's also a prayer for the city. It's a prayer for the nation. And that I wasn't at the harp and bowl 2 weeks ago. We share duties, as Izzy and I, with the kids. But Johnny, when Izzy was praying over the cities and nations and prophesying, there were arrows that had been released, and they were releasing arrows of fire into people, and they could see this thing happening. And as they were praying, Johnny went into this vision where he saw, as Izzy was praying, 12 angels arrived. And they were angels that listened to the prayer and were released. And then there was this coming and going. And then all of a sudden, he said, this vortex opened up where angels were coming in so fast. And he looked into this space, and it actually was the mouth of God. He could see God, and God released this wind, this fire, and out of his wind came angels of fire released as he was responding, and these thousands of them were just being released at the prayers of the saints. And he shared it a lot more detail than I could, because I couldn't see it. But we can see what the seers are seeing, and why I'm saying that to you is because it's the theme of fire. It's the theme of God hearing our prayers. When we pray, He hears us. You can say amen to that. When we pray, He hears us. When we pray, angels are sent on assignment. When we pray, God shifts the city and the nation. When we pray, things happen. It's important because when the seers, you know, in Acts chapter 2, the Bible says, well, Peter's prophesying and he's taking Joel's prophecy of, in the last days, I'll pour out my spirit on all people. And then he goes to say, what's happening now? This outpouring of the spirit, people prophesying and speaking in new languages and looking drunk. This is what that which Joel spoke about. And young men are going to have visions and old men are going to dream dreams and they're going to prophesy. And then we look at that and think, well, every time we get together, there should be people having visions. Come on. Every time we get together, there should be people having visions of what God is doing and sharing those visions so that we get to partake in what they can see. I can feel it, but I can't see it. But when the seer shares what they can see, like what Tanya did this morning, I could see what she was seeing. When Johnny was sharing about the 12 angels, it wasn't 11, it was 12. God's very specific. What was happening was very specific. And it's important that we honor the prophetic. That as God says to us, 4 months of embers, 4 months of burning, 4 months of fire, 4 months of leaning in. Just lean in. Just say, burn me up. Don't beam me up. Burn me up. Amen. Just say, God, whatever it looks like to be consumed, I want to be consumed. I want to know what that looks like, what that feels like. And it isn't necessarily more efforts and more time and more striving. It's actually the opposite. Sometimes it's more resting. It's more intentional about being with God. That's what it is. Amen. Because you see, Jubilee was a word spoken over us when we birthed this church. We birthed this church and we call it Jubilee because God told us to. God took me into an encounter in 1992 when I was just worshiping God in a conference setting with maybe 100 musicians. We were singing and worshiping God. And out of my mouth came this phrase, this is the day of Jubilee. And we are heading into the seventh year. This is the eighth year that we're going into since the last seven-year cycle. And we're into that as of tonight, the Sabbath year. And it's the seven times seven Sabbath year. So it's the year of Jubilee. This is the year of Jubilee starts tonight. So it's a pretty important occasion for God. And God doesn't go by January, he goes by September. And September has always been a time, over the last few years, God said to us, one September, it's a month of decisions. I'm like, oh, why is that? And we didn't put the two and two together. It's the new year. That's what Rosh Hashanah is. It's the new year starting tonight. And we realized in September, people make decisions. People change jobs. They decide to get married. They decide to leave the church. They decide to join the church. They decide to move cities. No, sometimes it's a blessed move. Hallelujah. People tell me I'm leaving the church. I say, awesome. I mean, God bless you. No, I just want to encourage you, because we don't own anybody. You know, no leaders own anybody. But I want to encourage you in this month of decisions of September. That's why God's encouraging us, lean in, that our decisions will be good decisions. That's the thing we want. We want wisdom. So the decisions we make aren't made in fear, because some people in the world right now are living in fear. They're like, what's going on? There's this massive exodus of people that are going across the earth, and what's going on? How's it going to end? We're going to take 13,000 people from Syria. Man, we could take a few more than that. Come on. I'm like, is that going to overwhelm us? Really? Most of us here this morning are immigrants, or our fathers or grandfathers were immigrants. Come on. And I'm like, what God's doing is taking a couple of million, mostly Muslim, not all, but mostly Muslim people, and moving them into many of them Christian countries or countries with a Christian leaning. This great disperse that hasn't happened for 50 years is happening on the earth right now. And what's going to happen is that a nation that for many, many years was the pariah of all the earth, when 6 million Jews were killed on German soil, now Germany. Of all nations, is the most generous. Come on. You think about that. You think about that, the great grandchildren of the Gestapo are now saying, we'll take 800,000. Ah, it's just mind-boggling. And I'm saying, what's going to happen to those families, those dispersed, vulnerable, poor of the poor? They have nothing, just a backpack if they're lucky. Maybe just their shoes and clothes. They've left, many of them engineers and dentists and professional people that had lives and homes and gardens, and they've left everything, and they're vulnerable. So we can't afford to be complacent in these days. But we say, Lord, there's such a big movement in the earth. How do we position ourselves? How do we lean into what you're doing? And we've got to lean in by being generous. We've got to lean in by being full of faith. Because whatever God's got, if Jesus comes tomorrow, we win. But I suspect that there's millions to be saved. Could I say billions? Let's say at least tens of hundreds of millions to be saved in the next while. We've only got, 1.2 billion Christians on the earth. I think we need a few more billion before Jesus comes. Come on. Come on. Amen. Come on. So whatever we are positioning ourselves for, we're going into a time of jubilee. And jubilee always is a time of canceling debt. So if you're in debt, it's a good time to reduce your debt financially. And if you're in debt emotionally, if you're in debt because of what people have done to you, if you had some trauma in your youth or in your childhood, in your adulthood, or you've had some trauma yesterday, it's a good time to release that debt. It's a good time to say, just as Jesus has forgiven me, so do I forgive you. That we begin the new year free of debt. Come on. Come on. Free of debt. Debt free. Doesn't matter how distant or how recent. God wants us to live debt-free. No one holding no one to account for what's been happened to us. Because at the end of the day, I'm responsible for me. Sin came into the world through one man's decision, Adam and Eve. Through their decision, sin came into the world. It wasn't God's decision, because God gave us free will. But through my decisions, my good decisions, I will redeem both myself, my family, and those that I influence. Come on. That people around me will always hear good decisions. Decisions for good. Decisions for healing. Decisions for restoration. Decisions for generosity. Those will be the decisions that make up my life for the rest of my life. Because I want to be a person of Jubilee. Jubilee is about freedom. The whole message of Jubilee is a message of freedom. Is that God said, let the land for 7 years, you've worked the land in 6 years. In the seventh year, let the land lie fallow. What does that look like? Looks like rest. But say, Fini, how do I rest? Will you rest from here? You rest from your belly. I have never been busier in my whole life, and I've never been happier. Why? Because how do you rest when you have a job that involves looking after 400 people? You have a life that involves looking after 6 kids who are all busy. All three of our youngest children dance for 15 hours a week. That's classes and driving and motorcycles and 4 cars and food. They all eat every day, repeatedly. It's like I'm a grocery, basically. I'm like a ring me up. Food. They just text me what they need, which is awesome. But it's like, so every day is actually getting busier. Every week, the list of things to do gets longer. It never gets shorter. How many of you know that your list, your to-do list, it never gets done? You're doing it partially. You do what you can. So there's always incompleted things. But you see, when you do it from a place of rest, because we're in a Sabbath rest, we're in the rest of God. We're not striving to achieve, striving to get to make our mark, striving to get God's favor, because we already have favor. We're the apple of his eye. We're in favor. We're trying to get it. God has put us in a place of jubilee. He said, you are my jubilee. I am your jubilee. So I'm busy as crazy, but from a place of rest. From a place of happiness. Come on. Just things to do. Things, messages, texts, emails, phone calls. Where are you? Have you got Zoe? No, I don't know where Zoe is. Where are you, Zoe? I've got Kaylin. I thought you had Zoe. We've left another child behind, We've lost one. It's happened. More than once. uh, What is that? It's that God says we must see that we enter his rest. So our Jubilee looks like living in an incredibly busy city, and we don't have to become monastic. We don't have to know God's will or to enjoy this season. We've got to go and live in the Blue Mountains. We've got to go to somewhere with his green pastures. Well, actually, no, my green pastures are in the city, right in the inner city. God says, I will make you lie down in green pastures. And most of my garden is concrete. Come on. So I go to Centennial Park, where the Lord makes me lie down. I say, what are you doing? What are you lying down for? The Lord made me lie down. He made me. So no, but you're just goofing off. You're wasting time. No, I'm entering his rest. All those gardens that God's got throughout the city, beautiful Kensington and at Bondi Beach, there's beautiful grass that you can go and lay down, because the Lord says, I will make you lay down in green pastures. And what's awesome is there's no cows. I'm like, it's just other people. Come on. Also laying down in green pastures. This is a prophetic word for someone here. And what's awesome is the council mows the lawn and we just get to lay on it. And my concrete doesn't need mowing. So what does Jubilee mean? Jubilee is a song, it's a sound of freedom. It's a belief in your heart that all fear is dealt with. All anticipation of dread. The days of awe, the 10 days of awe, which is the day from Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur, those days of awe are the wonders of God. Not the awe of God where we're so afraid we can't go near him. Actually, he says we must draw near to God with our consciences that have been cleansed and purified by God. We can draw confidently to God, not because we have cleansed ourselves. Amen. Not because we have washed in the outer courts or we've done all the rituals. Actually, because he just wants us to come. He loves his beautiful, rainbow, diverse, multinational, cultured bride that he's got. Amen. He says, draw near to me. Draw near to me and I will draw near to you. So our assurance going forward into the next 4 months of burning is that we can draw near to God and he will draw near to us. That we're going to experience more fire. We're going to experience provision. We're going to experience healing. We're going to experience multiple salvations. People are going to get saved. We are heading into a season of harvesting like we've never seen before. That while people in the marketplace and people who have seen their super being eroded through stock market crashes, our faith is not in our super. Come on. Our faith is in God's provision. Come on. God is going to be faithful to us. We're not going to, he never sees the righteous forsaken or their seed begging bread. God in a moment can provide. God in a moment, a decision, a move, like Daryl's on the phone and he's trying to do something and the opposite happens and he makes $1,500 from that. That's the kind of thing that God's going to work towards our favor. We are God's people. And what it involves for us is to have a mentality and a language that agrees with that. Our language must be a language of jubilee. Our language must be not a language that brings up the old and brings up the past and repeats things that people have said over you. If those were not words of freedom, you must not repeat them. Come on. What comes out of your mouth is what you're sowing. What comes out of your mouth is what you can hear and those around you can hear it. It must be seasoned with life. It must be seasoned. You've got to change your confession. What comes out of your mouth must be full of life. It must be prophetic. Even as we're saying that every eye can see. And you say, Lord, my eyes can see. You know, when the seers prophesy and they tell us what they could see, these 12 angels and angels of fire and the cloud of witnesses, I can see them now. I used to say for years, I'm not a seer. But you see, my imagination is so rich and so powerful. Each of yours imagination is so powerful that if you can't see it supernaturally, like, I don't know if I can picture an angel. I don't know if I should. Should I picture Jesus' face? What does he look like? Well, he's Jewish, for crying out loud. You know? He's young, about 30. I don't know. You can picture that. You can picture him. You can worship him. You can picture angels. I do all the time. So when I'm in the worship, I'm picturing angels dancing. I'm picturing the songs, the sounds, the voices I'm hearing, the choirs, the multiple harmonies that I'm hearing. I'm like, I'm picturing that. And I'm like, I'm not sure if I'm just imagining that or if I'm actually seeing it. I don't really care. Why? Because all of those experiences are good experiences. You see, you can really imagine the negative. Doesn't take much rocket science to imagine negative things. Oh, I don't know, if this happens, I could lose that. That person, I don't know, they didn't find me back, I'm sure. They just don't want to speak to me anymore. You've had that thought? You text someone, they take 3 days to reply. They're angry with me. No, their phone, they lost their phone. It's so easy to be negative. It's so easy to paint the worst construction on something that's quite straightforward and simple. And for you to anticipate Jubilee and to walk into the 4 months of favor, 4 months of fire, 4 months of being full of God's presence, it's something you have to speak and think and speak and imagine. Imagine what that looks like. Imagine what it would be if you didn't say the things that people have said over you in the past, or if you didn't repeat the things that have hurt you in the past. Imagine if you broke that cycle and broke out and fasted from negativity. Just have a fast from negativity. Set your mind on speaking words of life over everyone around you, yourself and everyone around you, because you have the words of eternal life. You have words that can create or words that can destroy. The power of life and death is in the tongue. And so the word of Jubilee, what God's saying to us over these next 10 days of awe and then Yom Kippur and then as we go into the month of decisions, this month of September, make wise decisions. If you're not sure, find someone to talk to about it. Especially your spouse, if you're married. Amen? It's so important that you guys are in agreement. If you can't agree about it, don't do it. But what you agree on will be done for you. What you agree on, the power of two people agreeing. And not just husbands and wives. If you're single and you need someone to agree, the Bible says, if two of you agree about anything, get a prayer partner who's going to agree with you. Not just agree with what you say. Will you agree with me? No. That's just a yes man. We don't need yes men. We need people who are studied and can say, have you thought that through? Is it even biblical? Are you talented to have that kind of faith vision for that specific dream? But those are what we need in our life, because we need friends who are going to help us with fire, help us with energy, help us with joy. And my last word is just about the word of marriage. You know, I was with the Lord this week and I was like, Lord, why is it up and down, this relationship that I have with you? Sometimes it's very intense and very pleasurable and very amazing, and I'm weeping, and I'm on the floor, and there's fire, and its glory covers the earth, and there's services that just go on, and you can't preach, and it's crazy, and there's groaning, and I like services like that. Anyone been in services like that? And I want that all the time. And the Lord said to me, but we're in a relationship. It's like a marriage. And in a marriage, there are very intense times of passion and pleasure, and intense times of glory. And then there's times of just busyness. You pass each other like ships in the night. Like lots of things happening. But you're not less married. Come on. You're not less married just because you're not experiencing the intensity or the passion that at times are so pleasurable. You're not less married just because at times you have to work. And times you have to fulfill duties and obligations and just getting through life. And I felt the Lord say to me, well, that's like my bride. You're my bride. I don't love you less just because it's not so intense that every single time you're with me. Like, where's the intensity, God? Where's the fire? Where's the glory? I want glory all the time. Well, the reason why you have a honeymoon is because it's just so different to what your normal life is. It stands out. It's a high point. It's a notable time. It's a special time. And the Lord says, give me those special times. And other times, it's just hard work.
And if you look at the life of Jesus, he was like working with the Father every day. And there were times he'd like, no, I'm going to go. I have other things to do. And at times he withdrew to solitary places to be with the Father because he so needed to be restored and refreshed and encouraged, because every day of his life he was pouring his life out. And our lives will be no different to Jesus, because as he is, so are we in this world. And as the Father sent him, so Jesus has sent us. So we are it. We're going to get weary and we're going to get incredibly encouraged. We're going to have times of hard work and times of incredible ecstasy and just becoming drunk, as blind drunk in God's presence. And each of those seasons are just as good as the other. Every season is good. It's like a good season. What are you in? I'm a working season. What are you in? I'm in a sowing season. What are you in? I'm in a fire season. I just think, enjoy every season of God. It's no less than. It's not like, oh, what's the matter with you? Why are you laying down? I'm in a lying down season. He made me. Come on. You hear what I'm saying? Do you hear my heart? Is that we need to be the people at these next 4 months, whatever happens in the earth, we say, Lord, we're positioning ourselves in the fire of God. We're not afraid. We're not storing up tinned food for times of great lack. We want to be generous. We want to reach out. We want to do what we can to help touch those that are really, really suffering in the world. Amen. We want to do our bit. And we want to pray up a great revival storm that we're going to see a great harvest. Amen. Bless you guys. I did have verses for that. They're in Leviticus and Deuteronomy and Luke, Psalm 85. They're there, Psalm 23. I did mention the Bible, that's it. So, if you could just bow your heads for a minute. Then you may be here this morning and a friend might have brought you, or maybe you just found us on the website and you came to church this morning and you're not a regular church goer, but you thought, man, it's time for me to seek the Lord. And if you're here and don't know Jesus, the Bible says that he, Jesus, stands at the door and knocks. And if anyone hears his voice and opens the door, he'll come in. And that little simple action of opening the door is what we do. God knocks and we open. He initiates, we respond. If that's you this morning, if you're not in a place where you know God and have had your sins forgiven and feel like you're connected to the Father, won't you let me pray for you this morning? Just raise your hand where you are and say, Finn, I'd love to pray a prayer to open the door to God's love. Is there anyone here this morning? Just where I can see it, just raise your hand and then put it down again. I'd love to bring you close to God. It's a new year, and many of us are going to experience new things in this new year. Thank you, Father. No one putting up their hand? Okay. Well, folk, we're going to have time now. We're going to put some music on. If any of you need prayer, we have a beautifully equipped and loving and proficient worship team, ministry team, who are going to pray for the sick and maybe have prophetic words over you, whatever they've got. And we'd love to do that. And Daryl will help administrate that.
Definitely going to help. Wasn't that an amazing word this morning? How many people feel really encouraged right now? I feel super encouraged. Listen, I don't want don't leave just yet, just for 1 second. I want to give people an opportunity. We want to give you an opportunity to respond specifically to the Ember word. Now, I love the way that Izzy released that and said, "Look, there's no pressure. There is no pressure." And I just wonder if that word spoke to you, and you'd like to say yes to the leaning in for those 4 months, just stand to your feet. That's all. That's all. Nothing more than that. Because it's so special. You know what? Tonight is going to be a very fiery service, I think. And I might be able to convince the team to do an ember tunnel tonight. But for this morning, we'll do it. We'll do it this way. And so just put your hands out and just say, Father, I respond to that word. Would you bring me in to that place in your heart? That fiery place where I can experience even more of your powerful love for me. I want to be transformed. I love it when you touch me. So consume me. Make me combust in the next 4 months. and for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. That was it. Awesome, guys. So good. So if we can have the team come up and do, and we'll pray. Whatever needs you've got, we'd love to pray for you. But do please go and get your kids before you come and get ministry, if you have some. Brilliant.